Sorry for technical glitch. Myself, Muralidhar. I work for L.V. Prasada Institute. And today we have a stellar faculty, Dr. Sudarshan Kokar. And we have a guest visiting faculty, Dr. Kazi Shabir from Bangladesh. You can get started, sir.
Yeah, right.
So Dr. Sudarshan Kokar, you know, he doesn't need an introduction. Currently he's a professor and in charge of, you know, Lens Clinic at RP Center. And he's extremely a good surgeon and excellent speaker. So you can go ahead, sir, please.
Yeah. Thank you, Murli. Yeah, see, technology glitches. People take Apple, they have Windows, but then there's a technology problem. You have a C port, A port, D port. Every time I buy a new machine, I think it should support the old one. It's not happening, right? So I think we have to look into that matter. So what I'm going to be talking about today is pediatric cataract. Now, why is pediatric cataract important? Because these kids which you operate will be living 80 to 90 years ahead in their life. If you don't do them properly, they'll be blind for 80, 90 years. So if there's a blind kid or blind person in the family, what happens? You need one person to support that person. So two people are not adding to the GDP of the country. So the earlier you operate these kids, make them see the world and work on their own, stand on their feet, I think you're doing a great job for the nation. So it's, if you do a 10 cataracts versus one pediatric cataract, I think it'll match up if you see the cost-wise over a period. So today's scenario is a difficult case. All of you doing pediatric cataracts? 10 people only. Yeah, okay. Fine, that's good. And I'm sure Kazi is doing lots of cases in Bangladesh, right? Okay. So what are the challenges we have? One is a normal eye. The patient walks in and do the surgery. The eye excellent looks about between, I'd say, 20 to 21, 22. White to white cornea diameters and fine, about 10, 10.5. What if the eye size is bigger? You have a buphthalmic eye, size is 14, 15 millimeter of globe. Or it's a small eye, say 6 millimeter, 8 millimeter. How will you proceed for the surgery? So I'll be showing you the videos for all these. If you have capsular plaques, you can have lenses which are partially absorbed cataracts. That means the anterior capsule and posterior capsule has gone stuck and the lens volume has been lost. And the best way to pick up the lens volume is if you do a ultra UBMs on these patients. So I'll show you some UBMs showing that. Subluxation, I think Murli is going to cover up very well. The thing called PCD, posterior capsule defect. If you see unilateral patients, I think 60 to 70% of these patients will be persistent fetal vasculature or a posterior capsule defect. So if you have those defects, your surgical techniques should change a bit, and how you do it, I'll be showing you that. You can have patients coming with persistent pupillary membrane on the surface, and there might be a cataract under it, or there might not be any cataract under it. So if you remove it, then you can see. So I think I'll start, go ahead now. So if the size is big, if the eye is bigger, say about 16 to 17 millimeter because of buphthalmos, what are the problems you're going to get? Anybody? So the size of the lens which you put in this one has to be changed, and you can't change the size of the lens. So you have to change the technique. Now see, this eye is big. Can I have a pointer, please? This rexus which I'm doing is looking smaller in relation to the corneal diameter, but it's not, it's about 5.5. It's looking smaller because the eyeball size, the cornea size is big. It's a buphthalmic eye. So I make two openings, I go with my bimanual cannulas and I aspirate it. And now I'm doing the PCC. If you don't do the PCC, they'll always have a after cataract in these patients. So PCC is easier than the anterior capsule. Only thing is don't overfill the chamber. If you overfill the chamber, the posterior capsule will go posteriorly and it'll become difficult for you to cut. You see, it's almost the same size. Vitrectomy in these patients is very easy because as such the vitreous gets detached from all sides of the sclera because the eyeball is big, so it already is fluid. You have to put three-piece lens in these patients, always a three-piece, and capture with the optic. So when you do the capture of the lens, now irrespective of the size of the eye, irrespective of the size of the cornea, and irrespective of the size of the bag, those central 3-5 millimeter is where you stuck your lens and it's going to stay there forever. So that is the way to go. Now this is case scenario 2, in which the eye is small. This eye is about 8 millimeter across. You can do a rexus or you can go with a cutter. In case you're not putting an implant, you can just go ahead with a cutter and just eat it up and leave it a phakic.
you can give glasses, or once, and if the kid grows up, you can put a secondary IOL. Now you always do a PI in the eyes which are smaller. If you don't do a PI, these microphthalmic eyes will lead to glaucoma. So you can handle the smaller eyes and bigger eyes, right? What happens if you have a plaques on the capsule? It's not always that you get a clear cornea, a clear anterior capsule, and you can go ahead and do your excess. So if you have plaques, scenario number one, you got a plaque up here, the rest is fine. So you start your excess, you always initiate with a cystitome, and the excess has to be completed with the forceps. You can't do without the forceps. So you're going and you get stuck here. You're getting stuck here. So you can use the plaque as a fulcrum to allow you to go around it. So I'm going around it. This pupil is about a 3-4 millimeters. So my plaque and the excess, Murli, you're late. Come in. Oh, we already got a Murli. So you got two Murlis. We can have a symphony. Now, this is the second scenario. You got a plaque which is here, and less than half of the anterior capsule is visible to you. So I do a rexus in some bit, and the other bit I do a cut. So you cut with the scissors and always leave a frill of the fibrosis outside. So if the frill stays with fibrosis, now this is at the end of the surgery. Now this is a scenario in which anterior posterior capsule is stuck. It's like a rock solid hard membrane. So what you need to do is, if you do with a cutter, it might not cut very well because the cutter has its own capacity, especially 23, 25. I think 27 gauge will break if you try to do this one. It'll cry. So you make a scissor, take a scissor. You make two openings and go 360 degrees. And if you're not happy, make three openings, four openings. Ensure you get a circular cut. I mean, openings are not a problem. And this is what my British, all the UK guys do. They're so scared of doing PCC first, so they put in the lens first and then they do it from the back. It's fine, I think they can do that way also. So there's so many ways you can skin the cat. I think this is what. So all these Britishers who are not very good at surgery, this is what you do. But I'm sure Kazi and Murli, they're all doing the PCC first and then putting the implant, and that's the right way to do it. All right, so you've taken care of the size, you've taken care of the capsules, subluxations, I think he'll cover up. Should I show something? Okay, so subluxation is a different ballgame altogether. So what happens here is the lens is not in the patellar fossa. Let's hope the video works. Yeah, you guys are lucky. Now this surgery was done at Westmead Hospital in Sydney. They called me to do this surgery. The other eye, the local guy had done, and he'd put a sclera fixated lens. So this was a challenge. Now this is a clear lens, but it's globular lens, and it's coming into anterior chamber. So I went ahead, did a two-port opening. Helon GV was used. I mean, there's no way you can do a rexus without that. And once you do that, you do a rexus in this one, and it's a mobile lens. The good thing is that the posterior hyaloid is strong. It's holding the lens in the place. So that you can take for your advantage. And what you need to do is, it's a globular lens. You want to make it flatter. So to make it flat, you have to put in a moisture or a CTR. I think I'll run through the video. This is not edited one. All right, so after the rexus, you put in a moisture ring, and the moisture ring has gone in. Not yet. I'm sorry, this was not edited once. Murli, I thought you were covering this, so I didn't do this. But anyway, so once you do the aspiration, you've done the moisture ring, and after the moisture ring, you have to put in a segment to fix it to the sclera. About 15 years back, I did two patients in which I put a lens in the bag, and I was very happy. Those patients came back to me with a CTR. They came back to me after 6 years with bag, CTR, lens in the vitreous. So you have to fix it to the sclera with the suture, which is non-absorbable suture, which can hold it there. All right? If you're not using that, you're doing the thing halfway. You're not finishing the game off. You're just leaving the thing for the tail enders, and you might get in trouble. So you have to finish that. And then you make a scleral pocket there and put in the sutures and put it in. And once this is done, the lens goes in, and this is what it looks like. And this patient had a 6-9 vision on the first day. On constriction of the pupil, we realized that they already attempted PIs here, and this is what it looked like. And patient has been followed up. I went to Sydney last month, and we saw this patient, and he's doing good. There's no problem with this patient. Okay, so these are the other kind of subluxation you can get. You can have this one, you can have this one, you can have this one, and you can have this one. This looks like a clear lens, but it's not a clear. It's a clear lens, but it's sitting in the anterior chamber. Now this is a patient in which you put a Sioni ring and single piece. See, the posterior capsule is quite clear, there's a little bit of wrinkling, but if you don't put a CTR and put the implant, this is what happens. Now this entire complex is going to get dislodged into the vitreous, and even if you do a YAG, it's not going to work because it's mobile and you have not fixed it to the sclera. So this is not the way to do it. And this is 1 year after the
implant. If you see this one again, now this is much clearer. Murli, you have to, you see the knuckle of Sioni here? You have to put it to the sclera if you want a complete answer to this problem. Okay, so now this is what I was saying. UBM, you see UBM, you do a UBM one day, it looks like this, the other day it looks like that. That means the lens is mobile. Otherwise also you can see if sometimes the kids don't show, this was published. All right, so how do you take out this lens? Murli, just tell me when you want me to stop. We have enough time, right? Okay. Okay, so that's the patient I talked to you about. Now, this lens is sitting on the iris. One, somebody can say, leave it alone. Should we leave it there? The answer is no, because it's going to eat up the cornea. And Murli, the cornea guy, I think he's going to be very angry. So you have to take it away. And there's no point in pushing it back because there's no space here. So we described this technique called intralenticular lens aspiration. So I, with the MVR, went all the way into the bag. Again, I went all the way into the lens. This lens has to be taken out. So what is the best way to take it out? You do that, and then you put in your cannula aspiration on one side. I always use a cutter on an IA cut mode. So there's no cutting in that. I use it as a bimanual. But in case I want to cut, I can always cut it. So this irrigation one port will go, we'll go inside all the way into the lens. I think the incision was not made complete. All right, so that's in, I'll go a little forward. Yeah, so it goes in. Gopal, welcome. So you go on all the way into the bag and you're stabilizing the bag here, and the other aspiration comes in. So you're inside the bag, although you haven't done a rexus there, but you're inside, and with a gentle suction aspiration you can take away all the material from there. It's a very soft putty like material. You can just suck it up. There's no issue. So once you suck it up, you can easily eat out the bag also. And the patient is a fake egg. You can put a scleral fixated lens. You can put an iris claw lens. Whatever you fancy, you can do that. You can leave the patient a fake egg. Whatever you're taking. But this has to get out of the way. If you don't remove it, the patient's going to be high myopic, minus 18, minus 20. And eventually will need a keratoplasty because the endothelium would have been compromised. Now once I aspirate this all. Okay, now that's the bag which is left. So I can eat it up. But what I'm doing is I'm going with my forceps. Just to show off a bit, I'm peeling it off. From wherever I'm peeling off, you can see the oozing of the on the iris. So this iris has started reacting to this lens as a foreign body and started sending vessels there to handle it, to absorb it. But because the capsule is there, they can't. You see the bleed there? So once the bag comes out, we send this bag in the formalin and they could open and make an entire lens out of it. So just stop with that one. It's not important. Only three speakers, so I don't need that. I'm doing more than what I was asked to do, Murli, so tell him. So then you do with a vitrectomy. No, it's fine. It's our session, no problem. Okay, so once you do that, you do a vitrectomy, and that's what it looks like at the end. Right, and you can actually see that impression of the capsular bag on the iris. It looks beautiful. All right, so then it's your call. Whatever you want to do in this patient, you can go ahead and do it. So this was a severe subluxation. I'm sure Murli is going to cover this in big one. Shahs are late. Come, sit. Come in the front. Okay, now I'll come to this little later. And PCDs. Now, what is the sign of the posterior capsule defect? You have a fishtail sign. So what does a fishtail sign look like? So if you see this patient, if the patient is big enough on the slit lamp, you see that's what it's like, a motch for the bangla. Fishtail, so it wags. So what happens, because of the opening of the posterior capsule, the lens matter goes into the vitreous and causes some reaction, and the vitreous gets liquefied there. And those white spots there, it will move like the fish wags the tail, the fish tail sign. So I'm not putting a fluid. I'm manually dissecting the plane there. And then with a cutter. Now this is a cutter. I'm going to eat up all the cortex. I'm more on aspiration. You can see my parameters here. Cut is almost zero here. And what I'm doing is I'm using the aspiration for taking out the cortex. And once that's gone, I'm eating the vitreous. Now you see the white dots. That's what is a fish tail kind of thing. You see, it's wagging at the back there. So eat up all the posterior vitreous. Now what I did was I left this anterior axis round. That's the posterior axis, which is oval, and I left some hyaloid here, so I can put a single piece in this one. This is a new technique we started. So in case the hyaloid are not strong, you put a three-piece lens. Ideally speaking, you should always put a three-piece in this one, but if you can get this kind of configuration of the posterior capsule, you can go ahead and put a single piece also. And this patient did pretty well actually. So you can handle the PCDs. Fishtail sign can be seen, and three pieces better for these patients. Now, if you have a persistent pupillary membranes, which I talked about, and that could be a precursor of the PFB. I'll come to the PFB a bit later.
Now, this is what it looks like. Now, see, the parents brought to you for the cataract. I took a Sinsky with a Helon GV. After the Helon GV, I just broke it from away from the center, not at the center. So once I got that one, I can actually take my forceps, take a grip, and move it all around. And once I removed it, I saw the lens was clear. So why should I fool around with a lens which is clear? So I didn't do anything. I left this patient, and the patient is fine. So we just did the refraction and left him alone. So he's doing good. All right, so this kind of opening is good enough. I was ready to operate it, but since it didn't happen, so we let it be. Okay, so what happens, the second case scenario, if there's a cataract under it, you can always go ahead and take it out. So you guys are lucky the videos are working here. Okay, so the same kind of picture with the persistent pupillary membrane coming from the periphery, right, getting stuck in the center. And once I made an opening, I realized there's an anterior subcapsular cataract, almost anterior polar kind of picture here. Not a very clear video. Guys, you can see that from there? Yeah, okay. So once you get that one, you remove as much membranes you can, and then you go in the center, and I think I'll cue it forward. All right, so now that's what after removing the membrane. The pupil opens up, but there's a cataract here, so we thought might as well go ahead and do it. So when I'm doing the surgery, please look at the parameters I'm using. So you can adjust with the simplest of the machine also how much aspiration is good with you and how much is the cut rate or whatever the infusion you want. And make sure that the openings that you make on the side port are as good as your incision, as the instrument which is going in. My these Duet bimanual goes very well from 1.2, not with the 1 millimeter side ports. So I'd use 1.2. So with the 1.2, I can go and I can actually block any fluid coming out, and that's what it looks like. No. Because it doesn't look pretty. And then you go ahead and do a PCC, because if you don't do the PCC, again, it'll be a after cataract formation and all your hard work is gonna go waste. I think in pediatric cataract till 7 to 8 years of age, you must do a posterior capsular excess. Otherwise, there's no point. And once you're doing a PCC, please do a little vitrectomy and go under the margins so that the margins fall back and there's no tag coming into the chamber. And then you can put a single piece lens if your X is intact. Anytime you can do that. So this is what this patient looks like at the end. All right. What do we have next? I don't even know myself. All right, so you have a patient of uveitis, which is something like this in both eyes. Yeah, so what will you do? Hanji, any options here? Murli? Now this is stuck up here, all pass. That's the cataract and that's the area you have. So what do? You can't split. It can't go, it's so firmly attached, it can't go anywhere. So you have to go all the way through and through under the iris here and then coming over the iris and going in. Let's see what we did in this patient. I won't ask everybody to do this, but in case you get these kind of patient. Now see, I'm going with the MVR and all the way in and coming up here under the iris. So that's my side port. Then I'm coming up here again under the iris, over the capsule bag and right here. Okay. Now, you just can't put a forceps and do a vitrectomy. So what you need to do is take a cutter, eat the anterior capsule, aspirate the cortex and cut the posterior capsule and do vitrectomy. And then if you have space, put a three-piece lens there for rehabilitation. Otherwise, you can leave the patient aphakic. So aspiration happens as routine, as normal as any other surgery. And then I enlarge it to 3.2, the same incision, right? So there's a pass already here and the three-piece goes in. I think I haven't done the posterior excess cut in this yet because I want the support. Because if I'd done that, the lens would have gone into the vitreous. After this is done, I go again behind it and doing a cutter now. Now this is the condition in which I do the posterior cutting after the implantation lens. In other 99.9, I'll do it anterior. So this is what the patient. And the patient got 6/18 vision, followed with us for a couple of years, then lost to follow up. I don't know where this guy is, but this can be done. Both eyes are bad. This was the worst eye. In fact, the other was equally bad. Not even finger counting. It's just patient has become ambulatory now. So you can help these patients to become something. So now I think I'll go to my topic, which was given to me, which is the persistent fetal vasculature. Now, persistent fetal vasculature. We're good, Murli, time? So you want me to expand it or stick to 5, 7, and I think I'll show you a video and I according
In the video only, I can tell what is happening there. So persistent fetal vasculature, one should know what it is, how to diagnose it. So it's basically a unilateral condition, and 27.6% of these patients of the unilateral cataract, according to a study done at RP Center, were persistent fetal vasculature. So if you find a unilateral cataract with a small size of the eye, with a membranous cataract, and which has a brownish hue, even if you don't have an ultrasound, please suspect a PFB. You won't be wrong. IATS study said, you all know about the IATS study, they said 22% were persistent fetal vasculature. This was when they took the patients who are more than 9 millimeter across diameter. So, and the other ones excluded. If they had taken those patients also, this would have gone about 50%. So it varies in literature from 14% to 70% of the unilateral cataracts. But if you're safely, you can say about 30% will be there. You can see some vessels on the surface. And most of the time, if you see the vessels on the surface, you're sure that blood supply is coming from the back. And this is what is a persistent fetal vasculature. When the anterior segment of the cornea and the lens forms, they both are avascular. We all know that. So how does it form? Each of us, when we were intrauterine, we had the blood supply coming from the retina, from the back, to the front of the eye. And once its thing has formed and healed, it retracts back. So by 21st of the week, they all will retract back. But unfortunately, kids in which there's a problem of growth and they don't retract back are the ones in which you still have the blood vessels just coming from the back. Okay? So that's what you have to see. These eyes are usually smaller because they stopped growing. So they stop growing by the age of 20 weeks. So whatever the size of the 20-week eye is there, you will have a PFP. After said that, it's not a sacrosanct that all the eyes will be small. You can have a normal size eye also, and you can have bigger size eyes also. You can have a secondary glaucoma also in these patients, but that's rare. So all these small eyes, microphthalmic eyes, secondary glaucoma, and detachments. Because once this membrane retracts or contracts, it can just pull off the retina from the back, and you can have RD. So, and secondary glaucoma, because all these vessels in the front will form a circle around, and you have persistent fetal vasculature, and they can contract and cause secondary glaucoma. So all these yellow kind of things, you should, and that's not in the front, in the back. So if the glow is yellowish and not white, always do ultrasound to rule out, one, a retinoblastoma, second, a persistent fetal vasculature. But a retinoblastoma eye will be a normal size eye, and PFB eye will be a smaller eye. So I think I'll give you a differential later on. Okay, so I'll run this video again. So what you need to know here is the four things. Come on, yeah. So what is PFB? I just told you how to diagnose it, how to operate, and why to operate. These are one-eyed patient, prognosis is very poor. So why should you go ahead, put the kid under anesthesia and go with the vitrectomy, first surgery, then second surgery, maybe 2-3 surgeries more? So that's what we'll be discussing now. So this is what you should be knowing. You see this persistent fetal anterior processes. They are sacrosanct. So that means there were the blood vessels going along with them, and once the retraction, there's a cataract in the middle, but they're still there. So this is a typical anterior segment finding of a PFB, persistent fetal vasculature. If you have any side where the ciliary processes are more prominent, it becomes PFB. Is it clear for you guys from there? Yes. Okay, great. Second is ultrasound. Now ultrasound will pick up a stalk which is coming from the middle all the way up, but only 70% of the patient will pick up ultrasound. 30% it doesn't pick up because you don't spend the time on that, and your angulation is not the right. So you keep repeating the scans till you pick it up, or the best way to do is 100% is a MRI, which is a costly thing. Now see, this eye is small, as I promised earlier. This lens is bloated up, and there's a stalk which is going. You can see that very clearly. And that's a CCT. In case you don't have MRI, you can do this, but this is not an answer. Even the CCT doesn't give you 100%. MRI is an answer. Most of the people will do ultrasound and pick it up. So this is what everybody should be able to see. That's how you diagnose a PFB, persistent fetal vasculature. Along with that, smaller eye and the grayish looking cataract helps you. Okay. One second. Yeah, so if you want to operate now, how do you operate this patient? You can go from pars plana. The retinal surgeon can go from pars plana. But the problem is the pars plana, there's no detachment in these patients. So the retina guys are not getting stimulated. They're not excited about going in these patients, because what they say, there's nothing for us in it.
it's the lens which is the problem. So you remove the lens and send the patient. So we started doing this. Now all the retina colleagues are sending. I've become a dump yard there. All the PFBs are with me. So we've done about 101 patients. I'll just show you all the data. So anterior root is what I do because that's where I'm confident. Bleeding could be a major issue because there's blood vessels growing, going under it. So what you need to do is you need to have a diathermy or a plasma blade. Plasma blade has stopped manufacturing. So I have a last piece which is left with me, which is going to work another 6 months. It's going to become defunct. So diathermy is available on all the phaco machines. So that's what I'm going to show in the videos, how we do it. And one single test, which I think most people don't have, if you have a good radiologist support, you can do a Doppler in these patients and you can see the blood flow. Now, this is what a surgical video is. Now, that's the membrane. You can see the vessel there. And that's just a membrane. There's no lens left in that. All the cortex is gone. So I go ahead, make an entry and cut it. And see, the moment I cut it, you can see the ooze here. You can see the bleed coming. So I take my diathermy. No fancy plasma blade, nothing. Diathermy from any basic phaco machine. And you can just, and then you go ahead, keep eating it up till you have. Now you can see the cilia processes, all of you. And I've cleared up the media. And that's what we do now. We put a wide angle with the ILU from the front, and we can actually pick up all these snakes dancing at the back. So that has gone back, and this does not cause anything in the future because there's no traction left. Now, since there's no anterior posterior capsule, I will not put a single piece in this one. I'll put a three-piece lens in the sulcus over the cilia processes. And over the cilia processes, you just cannot put a single piece because the optics are square edge and they're thick. They'll cause lots of uveitis, and this is the safest way to do. Now, this is the second patient in which, after doing the aspiration, what you realize is, what happens in this patient, the blood vessels are already there. So, moment your chamber goes shallow, it starts oozing. Now, this is what is a salmon fish sign. Like a fish, salmon fish sign. So, whenever this happens, this we published about, I think, a couple of years back. This goes by our name, and I'm using a plasma blade here. You see, that's the flicker you get with the plasma blade, and the plasma can cut it so well. So I've cut it around. So even if you don't have a plasma, you can use diathermy. I'm no financial interest. And that's a stalk, and I'm cutting the stalk off now, you see. And then the stalk has fallen back. I've done a vitrectomy. You notice my posterior membrane has a rigid margin all around capsule. So I can go with a single piece in the bag because the posterior is not going to expand. Anterior is also taken care of with a manual rexus. So this is what it looks like. Now this is another scenario. You can see the PFB stalk at the back, pupil well dilated. So I make a nick and I cut it. So I was trying to leave a fibrosis band all around on the posterior capsule. Anterior capsule rexus is a cakewalk in these patients, not a problem. So once you cut it all around, and I think this is the video I made for the resident to see that you can see the stalk throughout. And then I coagulate in the center, and I coagulate on the stalk. So the stalk, which is brown in color, I'll coagulate and make it white. Divide all the blood, and then you can cut it very easily. So I'm going with the diathermy at the back. And if the stalk is thinner, you can cut it with the diathermy itself. And it cuts very well. So once it cuts, you can take it out, do a vitrectomy, and that's about it. And then since the posterior surface is good, you can just put the lens inside in the bag. I'm telling you this video is because PFB is not that rare. Unilateral patients, I think 40 to 50% of your patient will be persistent fetal vasculature. So if you start looking at the patient, you realize what you're missing out. So you have to do this patient rather than sending them here and there. And as such, the unilateral visual prognosis is not very good. So earlier you better operate, the better it is. Now again, if you see, the lens seems clear, but it's all in the back. So the moment you go in, it's half part which is involved, half is not involved. And there's a fibrosis all around in the anterior capsule. So you cut it and they take a cutter. You have to have a good cutting machine with you, a good vitrectomy machine, and again a Salmon patch sign. You see those blood vessels oozing? Now you go with the diathermy. In fact, they tell you where to coagulate. So you can take your diathermy and coagulate at the areas, put in some Helon there and coagulate these vessels. See, I'm coagulating them one at a time. Here, here, here. And then you can cut it and use a vitrectomy probe and get away with that. So persistent fetal vasculature, you'll have to handle the bleeding. Otherwise, next day, the chamber and the vitreous will be full of blood. Don't take a risk there. All right, so this, after cutter, it Now that's another patient in which it's white cataracts. We can't see anything at the back. Ultrasound had a suspicious stalk in this one. So I aspirate everything in the front. And when we saw at the back, there was a posterior capsule defect in this patient. You see that PCD, which is oval, it just come in your view. Okay, so we eat up everything at the back. And this is a stalk. You can see the shadow. That's a stalk. That's a shadow of the stalk.
All right, so I think there's one more video here. Then I think I'll call it a day. All right, so again, if you see, now this is what I was trying to show you. So that's the posterior capsule defect, oval, pre-existing. So 25 to 30% of the patient in PFB will have a defect in the posterior capsule. That's a known fact. So if you have it, you have to do a vitrectomy. Now in this one, if you notice, the stalk has come not in the center, off the center. So I left the stalk intact in this patient. Because it's not coming in the visual axis, I left it alone. Now this was a patient in which after doing entering, it was too immature and this surgery had to be abandoned. So if you don't handle the blood vessels properly, this is what you're gonna get with. So this was all blood all over. But it can happen. So out of 101 patients, one patient was like that. So why we want to operate? That if you don't do any surgeries, the vision is nil in these patients. So my best case scenario is I got three patients out of 101 which have 6x18 vision in that eye because of rehabilitation. About 77 patients had less than 6x60 and nil vision in 21 patients. So that's the data of 21 patients. So if you see the literature, the older the data, PL visions are very poor, but now it's coming up because the cutting machines, diathermy, everything has evolved and you can get away with that. And this is the last slide. Color Dopplers, I think I'll show you the video of the color Doppler. Color Doppler should be done in these patients to pick up the blood flow. Salmon sign, if you see on the table, you're sure these are the ones which are going to bleed. So please use diathermy in these one. And hemostasis and surgery must be done in these. You might get some useful vision in these patients. And has to be done in these patients. I'll just show you the Salmon patch sign, the Doppler video, and then we'll finish it off. And where's the Doppler video gone? Yeah. So you can see that. So you saw that one. So the blood flow, you can see the veins and the arterial blood. So that is the one which is actively showing. And that you can do in the kids of 5 years to little senior age group. Younger age group, you can't pick up the Doppler very well. I think with that, I'll stop. Murli, we can have the questions at the end, please. All right. Murli, I'm done.
Sir, what proportionate of cases in your series had a bilateral involvement?
Okay, so out of 101, we had three patients, he had bilateral, and we have two patients which had optic disc coloma mass. So the stalk was not coming from the optic nerve head, it was coming at the end of the coloma. I have the pictures, but I thought maybe this audience. Okay, so we had two patients with coloboma and three patients with had bilateral. Yeah, Kazi.
Yeah. Just to know that because the many of the cases they come so early, and do you like to put the lens in the primary surgery, like if you do the surgery at 3 months old,
yeah.
And do you like to put a lens?
See, I put the lens not on the age base. I put the lens on the anatomy and the health of the eye. If my eyeball size is about 9.5 millimeter across white to white, and the axial length is more than 18 millimeter, I'll put an implant even if the kid is 1 day old. But if the kid is smaller, I don't want to push in a lens there. The problem is if I don't put a lens in a unilateral, what is the answer? Unilateral FAK glasses are not an answer. Contact lenses in Indian setup in North India, it's not an answer. We tried in two patients, both had corneal ulcers. And they don't clean the lenses, they don't use it properly. I mean, contact lenses in my setup, I don't think it works well. So I'll put the implant, otherwise I'd give FAK glasses and occlusion 1:1. The parents are to be taught. It's not the child's problem, it's the parent's problem. The parent don't want to give occlusion treatment because if they close the seeing eye, the child is going to cry all over. But that is short term. Eventually, it will gain. So, Kazi, I'll put an implant in unilateral cataract safely if it's possible, irrespective of the age, but depending on the size of the eye. Yeah.
Yeah, I would agree, sir. We do the same thing.
Because there's no way you can rehabilitate these eyes. And those 6/18 vision was in three patients was because of the eye wells. So, I'm very aggressive on that, and I'm doing it. And no secondary glaucoma has happened in any of these patients. So I think if you can believe that, follow it.
Yeah, I would also agree with, even if they don't have any visual potential, we have to really go ahead and operate in order to give a good anatomical outcome. Otherwise, only two things are possible.
True.
Either they end up having a phthisis or they end up having a secondary glaucoma.
True.
Both are, you know, unacceptable outcomes.
Even detachments can happen later on. So earlier you operate and take the traction with the cutter vitrectomy, I think it works well.
Thank you, sir. Thank you once again. Are there any questions for us, sir? Couple of questions we can take.
Dr. Leela, question.
How do the biometry of the young children?
Sure.
2-3 months old.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So the biometry of these ones have to be done on the table.
Yeah.
In the bigger kids, you can put them on the aisle master and any funny thing, and that's very accurate. But it's not possible because aisle masters don't work horizontal, they work vertically when the patient's vertical, not horizontal.
So you have to do a biometry manual. Okay, so there could be a tox that when you do manual, you press on the cornea, you might have defect errors of one or two. If you have errors of plus minus two diopters, you are still hitting the target. You can never be accurate because these are eyes which are growing. These eyes will grow about 0.6 millimeter per month for the first 6 months. So 0.6 into 6 becomes 3.6 millimeters. So 3.6 millimeter of the eguline grows in first 6 months. So if you're taking the lens early, you have to undercorrect it to some extent. Have you all read my article in IGO in which I talked about the biometry? No, you have read it. So you have to do undercorrection in this patient. I'll tell you what the formula is. So you do a keratometry and biometry on the table in all these patients and then calculate the undercorrection. So if the kid is 2 years and above, 2 years, you do 5% undercorrection. At 5 years, you do 2%. And after 5 years, you take emmetropic lens. Okay. So 1 year to 2 year, you do about a 10% undercorrection. And less than that, you do 15%, 3 to 6 months. And less than 6 months, you do 20% undercorrection. It's a rough estimate. The good way of doing is N. Biardi's rule, that age of the patient and the refractive error should be 7, lucky 7. So if it's a one-year-old kid, you need a 7 diopter refractive error. So put the lens accordingly. 3 months, again, 1 plus 7. So it's less than 1 year. So 7, right? The formulas which were given by Dahan, Prost were doing 20% undercorrection for 2 years. So all my patients which I tried 20 years back with Dahan, I had to remove the lens because they were hyperopic to the tune of 8 to 10. So anytime the power is more than plus minus 7 diopters, I give an option to the patients to exchange the lens. And these lenses can be exchanged very well. The only trick is when you take out the lenses, the single piece, a single piece is not going to go in the bag again because the peripheral will get fibrous. So the lens which goes in will be a three-piece lens always. So what you do is you make the opening about 5 millimeter, put the haptics in the sulcus and capture the optic with a three-piece, which I showed you in the first video. If you can do that, you can never be wrong in these patients. You have to put a three-piece in and biometry on the table and you have to undercorrect these ones. But not to the tune which, so my study says that Indian and Asian eyes don't grow that much. So we did a cohort in which we took 60 patients each, less than 6 months, 6 months to 1 year, 1 year to 18 months, and more than that. In each of these patient group, we did the surgery, we did the calculation, excellent, and we followed them for 6 months each cohort. So 6 months kids became 1 year, 1 year became 1.5. So we had this entire system in which we could see what is the growth. We realized that our system is the same which I told you. At 1 year, you do 10%. At 2 years, you do 5%, and the similar way. It's available in IGO. Otherwise, if you want, I can give it to Kazi. Kazi has it, so you can just take it from him. You're from Bangladesh, right? Right, so you take it from Kazi. Kazi is chasing me all over the world. Wherever I go in US or Singapore or China, he's always sitting in one of the corner and eyeing me. He always asks me a question, I know.
No, I'm learning still.
Learning, you're doing good, great job. So I think that's good then. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Can I have my slides, please? It's on. See, I got disconnected, it works.
On it.
HDMI. Yes, sir. You have your presentation loaded? Yeah, sure.